Clause 10. Make sure that the right copy is printed so that we will not also be confronted with issues of different copies being circulated. Clause 10. It is proposed that clause 10 as amended stands part of the bill. Those in favor, please say aye. Those not in favor, please say no. The ayes have it.
Clause 11. Estimate.
Willis.
Discuss their recommendation with us. You just put it to us.
He read it twice, but in the interest of transparency, can you read it for him?
Okay. Can I read again the recommendation? The recommendation we made on this clause is to make the introductory statement, subsection 1, as shown above, and insert subsection 2 to specify the authority that determines payment of emoluments and allowances and benefits, which was actually lacking. So essentially, with the clause expenditure of the commission, you have one, the commission may apply its funds, then you have A, B, C, D, and then you have subclause 2 to say the emoluments, allowances, and benefits of the commission shall be determined by the minister in consultation with the Public Service Commission. Those are the only things we change.
Issues to the proposal of the committee's recommendation. I'll read it again. I'll put the question again. Member for Woolley is, do you have any other issues on that recommendation? Honorable members, in the absence of that, it is proposed that clause 10 as amended stands part of the bill. Those in favor, please say aye. Those not in favor, please say no. The ayes have it.
Clause 11, estimates, accounts, and audit.
Clause 11, estimates, accounts, and audit. FPAC, can you lead us? Honorable members, if you have any issue or issues on clause 11, estimates, accounts, and audits, you may.
That's the report, yes.
It is proposed that clause 11, estimates, accounts, and audit, without amendment, stands as it is, stands part of the bill. Those in favor, please say aye. Those not in favor, please say no. The ayes have it.
Clause 12, annual reports of commission.
Clause 12, annual reports of commission. We will now, honorable members, the FPAC committee had no issues on clause 12, annual reports of the commission. There is a proposal that on the heading annual reports of commission, we should insert article D after of, to read as annual reports of the commission. Honorable members, can you look at that? Honorable member for Willis, it is proposed that clause 12, annual reports of the commission as amended, stands part of the bill. Those in favor, please say aye. Those not in favor, please say no. The ayes have it.
Clause 13, appointment of the executive secretary.
That is part 4. Part 4, clause 13, appointment of the executive secretary. FPAC committee, do you have any recommendation or issues on your report? Please use your mic, sir.
We don't have anything, but I just wanted to call this to the attention of the minister. If you look at 13 subclause 2, the executive secretary shall be recommended by the commission after a competitive selection process and appointed by the president after consultation with the Public Service Commission and the commission. So is that not redundant or? Yeah, we saw it, but we just wanted to be certain. By the Public Service Commission and the commission.
So the proposal is to delete the last line that, and the commission. Yeah, that's what he's saying. The Attorney General is recommended that we delete and the commission. Member for Atikunda Sabi.
I want to be very clear with this provision. The executive secretary shall be recommended by the commission. That's the commission itself. They have to choose within themselves. Like five commission member, you choose one to be your executive secretary. No, can please, someone explain this process, please?
Allow him to finish. If he asks anything, one of you can use your mic to explain.
Yeah, after a competitive
Before
selection
the,
process.
The honorable member for Pasala.
Yes, what this is referring to is the executive secretary, who is the administrative head of the commission. It has nothing to do with the commissioners. The commissioners actually are separate, but after the appointment of the commissioners, now is the appointment of the executive secretary. Yeah.
Honourable Member Fola Adekunle Asabeji.
That is the, now, the president will make the appointment in consultation with the public, Public Service Commission and the two commissions. That is the president, what happened, if these people say, they don't want the one recommended by the commission. What's their role? The role of these two commissions should be very clear here. But in consultation, it's like you appoint, probably consultation in this condition, that is just like for your information. But you don't have any role to play. And we need to see the role that is going to be played by these two commissions. We need to be very clear about that, please.
Yeah, no, you note it down. I'll go to Wooly East. I'll come back to you.
Yes, the way I see it is that you have two, if recommended by the commission, since it is recommended by the commission, since the person is recommended by the commission after a competitive selection process, the consultation with the Public Service Commission should be enough.
Honourable Member, please. Order, order. Order, please, on my far right.
I'm saying if the executive secretary is recommended by the commission, you know, after that, before the president appoints, the president also, you know, consults the Public Service Commission. I think that is enough, instead of, again, and the commission. That and the commission, we should delete that one. Yes, I'm supporting that, I'm saying.
Honourable Member for Latikuna Sabiji.
One wants to make some clarification on my concern.
Brikamanot.
I only want to elucidate the point that is raised. For consistency purpose, This kind of appointment, the consultation is limited to PSC. The commission itself is not involved in the consultation.
Member for Olindo.
Yes, Honorable Chair, I don't know if that is in line, because I think for the recommendation of the Executive Secretary, in my opinion, I think that should be the responsibility of the Public Service Commission, and we remove the commission directly. I don't know if that is still possible.
The point that the Honorable Member for Olindo is raising is that the Executive Secretary, who shall be the administrator of the commission, should not be recommended by the commission itself. That's his...
I think we are all speaking the same line. The commissioners would make the recommendation. Then the president, in consultation with the Public Service Commission, takes those recommendations and make a decision.
No, his point is that the Executive Secretary should not be recommended by the Commission. That's what he said, not this PACD. You know, sorry, can you minimize here? Yeah, please respond.
But we differ with the Honorable Member for Olindo. For the Commission to do recommendation, that is okay. But for them to be further involved in the consultation, that's what we are trying to say. Let's limit to the PSC, where it's added, and the commission. So we stop at the PSC and then forget about and the commission.
No, what he's saying, I don't know where you understand his point.
Okay, the opposite. Now, we understand what he's saying. He's saying that the recommendation must not come from the commission, but just go directly with the Public Service Commission. I think that's what he's saying. But again, we are dealing with an independent institution. And then we also try to solidify their independence. And that's the reason why we say let the commissioners recommend and the president consult with the Public Service Commission. That's all.
Yes.
Member for Brikama South.
Yes, Honorable Chair, I don't see any problem with regards to the commission. The recommendation here is kind of identifying. No, for me, the commission, the recommendation here is just an issue of identifying. But that is also going to be subject to the appointment of the president in consultation with the PSC. Probably like you look at the state-owned enterprise bill where they create a kind of database. So here also they can identify a list of people that out of which the president will also consult with the PSC and appoint. So there is nothing wrong with the identification, but not directly appointed.
Olindo.
Honorable Chair. What Honourable Member for Upper Salem said, and in fact all other members, with regards to my opinion, the fact that the commissioners are going to be appointed by the President, we're talking about autonomy, independence. The Executive Secretary should also be, appointed by the Public Service Commission. You don't allow the commissioners to identify the Executive Secretary. At the end of the day, we are not talking about independence here. You understand? He can be micromanaged. You understand? So I think it's important for us to leave that in the hands of Public Service Commission to deal with that. And then the commission has to be appointed by the president directly. Thank you.
Please, if you want to come, you use your mic. Sabah Sanja.
Thank you very much, Honorable Chair. I think I would like to support the idea of Honorable Member for Olindo. The commission should not recommend the Executive Secretary. I believe that the Executive Secretary should be recommended by the Public Service Commission and then appointed by the President, but not to be recommended by the Commission itself. You cannot recommend yourself at the same time appoint yourself. Thank you.
Nominated Member Kebalang Fofana.
Oh, I'm still raising my tack. Huh? Honorable Speaker, I think this one should not be a difficult one. Let's look at the appointment of the commissioners themselves. We are saying that the president should appoint these commissioners subject to what? the vetting of, initially it was the Public Service Commission, but now we are changing it to the National Assembly. No, so, which means you'll be having independent-minded people there. And again, this executive secretary is going to work for that commission. It is only fair that they are part of the process.
That's all.
You know? So I strongly believe that having the commission involved in the recruitment of the executive secretary is really, really good. You know?
I told the tag of law, but okay, Kiang West.
Yes, I definitely, the recommendation by the Public Service Commission to be appointed by the President, I am strongly against that. This is anti-corruption issues. This is anti-corruption issue. That recommendation could be accepted or not accepted by the President. If it is just recommendation, you recommend. But is there any thing to compel to say this is the right recommendation and you have to appoint that one? So otherwise, they could recommend, if it is the right person, President rejects. So is there anything to tell us when they recommend the right person, President has to appoint that? It's just about suggestion. This is what we have suggested to you, and you do your appointment. So putting President in the appointment of officers for anti-corruption issue, I have no trust in it.
Member for Fonye, Councillor.
Yes, thank you very much. For me, I think it's in line. My only difference is this. We cannot in totality remove the commission from this. If we do so, at the end of the day, it's going to be something else. Because the commission itself need to know who are the people that I will work with. This is one thing. Second, also, we cannot leverage. You know, here we have to understand the law and also issues that govern leadership. You know, here I agree that the president is not going to do blindly. He's going to consult with the Public Service Commission. So I believe that the Public Service Commission will not mislead the president. But what I disagree was is commission again. So if you can scratch the last end and it stops at Public Service Commission, I think it will do. Yes.
Yes, on that one, there is general consensus. What the issue now is that the executive secretary, who will be the administrator of the commission,
yes,
to be recommended by the commission themselves.
Yes.
That's what now the member for Woolley is.
Yes. Chair, I'm thinking about the National Human Rights Commission. What is the practice there? Because the practice there is, I think it's the same recommendation here. It's the National Human Rights Commission that identifies the executive secretary. When it comes to appointment, when there is a vacancy, it goes directly to them. If we can check that, maybe I believe we can just adopt that scenario.
Member for Brikamasa. Is it Brikamasa? Oh, sorry, Simon.
Chair, I think the commission should appoint its own.
Speak to your mic.
I think the commission should appoint its own executive secretary. The president should not involve, since he is accountable to the commission. The procedure in Human Rights Commission is the act for the appointment of executive secretary should be adopted for this commission.
All in them, please.
Honorable Chair, I think we are speaking the same language. The only contention we are having here is whether the commission recommend the executive secretary or not. You understand? Whether it is the best practice for the Human Rights Commission, we look at that. We may have done it that way, but we can also change. And there is nothing wrong in changing it. You understand? We are saying the executive secretary, who is going to be the administrator of the commission, can also be appointed by, you know, the president in consultation with the Public Service Commission. So the recommendation can be from the Public Service Commission and not the commission itself. You understand? That's what we are saying. So now, it is up to the chair whether we agree that, you know, recommendation be done by the commission and appointed by the president in consultation with the Public Service Commission, or the executive secretary be appointed by the president in consultation with the Public Service Commission, and then he will be recommended by the Public Service Commission directly. That's what we said.
Sebastian,
yes, I still want to maintain my point to support that the commission should not involve in the recommendation of the executive secretary. You cannot be a judge and a jury at the same time. You cannot recommend yourself to be an executive secretary. It's not going to work. Recommendation, I stand that the recommendation should come from the Public Service Commission. So the president, in appointing the executive secretary, should do it in consultation with the Public Service Commission. If we can also subject it to the approval of the National Assembly, and then we see.
Opa Salo.
Yes, honourable members, let's remember the thing. There's a big difference. The commissioners are not the executive secretary. The executive secretary is the head of the administration. I'm coming. Now, if you want us to do what we have in the National Human Rights, I can read what is there. If you want that, I can read it. No, because I think,
we are not going to copy from National Human Rights. We have to be innovative. Let's do things that are very unique here.
The member for Joshua.
That's what we want to do. That's why we want to do away with yours.
Chair, I think we have
to
look.
Chair, I have something to say, Chair.
Yeah, I think we have to go back and look at the purpose of the commission. By going through the purpose of the commission and coming back to the function of the executive secretary, I think we'll be able to know where we agree. Because if you look at the powers of the commission and also the function of the executive secretary, if you compare it to, then the minister can also help us through there.
Mr. Rekunda.
Thank you very much, Chair. I think this is very straightforward. The commission here, it states that the executive secretary shall be recommended by the commission after a competitive selection process. It's straightforward, I think. Yeah. We don't need to waste much time on this. And for the president appointing, I think that's the norm as per the constitution. Yes, most of the...
Member for Latikuna Sabili. Please.
No, thank you very much, Honorable Speaker.
No.
You see? I'm speaking. Okay, it does not necessarily mean that we are committed to this one's being recalled.
Brikama Saud, please allow the member to...
We are not committed to this norms being recalled, where we see ourselves that we cannot find a way out of these norms or this settled practice that are not progressive laws. For me, the executive interference to the process of this appointment is what I'm not comfortable with. What's the role of the National Assembly? Why can't we have the National Assembly recommendation come here, we deliver and we make the appointment, and then the president? Because the president himself is a subject of this anti-crime law, anti-corruption bill rather. So, for me, I would prefer the National Assembly. Sorry. I want to see the... I'm speaking, please. I want to see the role of the National Assembly in this process, please.
But there is point of order. Who is point of order again?
Bile.
There's
no
point of...
Bro, don't disturb people.
Ingo, please, put off...
You cannot just accuse people here.
Okay.
Please. It's not accused anybody.
Please, majority. There's point of order from the member for Oponyomi.
Okay, I think the honorable member should be very careful to restrict his discussion and argument.
What's the point of order?
29-1, my brother. 29-1. Don't forget.
Your point of order.
That's a sign of mastery.
Honorable Speaker, content of speech. Yes, content of speech, honorable care. Every member shall restrict his or her observation to the subject under discussion.
So what did I say? That is
what should you use the name of the president in your agreement?
It's a subject of the law.
Corruption.
For what? Huh?
Please, be very civil in your submission, honorable member.
If you don't put your house in order, we are not going to progress. Because I said the president is a subject of the law. Is that? So the president is not a subject of the law.
Be very civil in your submission, please, huh?
No. If you don't put the house, we are not going to progress because we keep doing on and on. I said the president is a subject of the law. And you bring a point of order. What was the point of order? What has that to do with my statement? No, I'm gonna please, because if you proceed like that, we are not going to progress. I only said the president is a subject of the law. You say point of order. Point of order on what?
Point of order. Point of order.
Huh?
Order.
No, you cannot hold confidence.
Point, no. Point of order.
Hello, please order. Honorable members. Honorable member for Latikunda, I gave you the floor to make your submission. In the process, there was a point of order in accordance with the standing orders. And it is only proper for you to allow him to put his submission and you allow the chair to rule. But by way of disrupting, you were out of order. And let us confine ourselves to the subject under discussion. We are on clause 12, and let's look at the clause 12 and progress. Now I am only allowing the minority leader then invite the Attorney General.
We've spent quite much time on the issue. Precisely, there are divergent views surrounding who should have the power to recommend. There are other side that says, as it is, the Commission can make recommendation subject to appointment by President in consultation with the PSC. Others are saying that power to recommend the Commission should not be involved. These are the two sides. Okay? Now, why we are still maintaining we have the Commission to be involved in the recommendation? Initially, the Commission itself was subject to vetting by Parliament, subject to appointment. And then, for who should administer that institution, I think it is proper the Commission also is involved, so that they vet who are those to be appointed as the executive secretary. But they will not be the appointing authority. And then the president does not have that sole power to do the appointment. Let's make that very clear. He cannot do his appointment outside the recommendation. He cannot do that. That the person to be appointed must be recommended by the commission, from whom he will consult the PSC for appointment. So absolutely, he does not have that power to outright appoint.
Honorable Attorney General and Minister for Justice.
I thank you, Honorable Speaker. I believe you should all have your constitution with you, a copy of your constitutions. Now, I refer you to section 175, paragraph 3. It reads, the chief executive of a public enterprise shall be appointed by the president after consultation with the board of directors or other governing body of the public enterprise. So in this case, the president to appoint in consultation with the commission is in order, is constitutional. That's what the constitution has. So the text is correct, except that we just need to remove the last three words, and the commission. So it's normal for the commission to recommend to the president, and the president in consultation with the Public Service Commission does the appointment. That's the language of section 175, paragraph 3 of the constitution. So it's more or less they've reproduced the constitution here. Yeah.
Chair.
Member for Sabasanja.
Yes, Chair, I just want to say that, yes, according to what the section that is quoted by the Honorable Minister, is still not unconstitutional for the the President to consult the Public Service Commission and not to consult the Commission itself. It's still not unconstitutional, I believe.
It says the chief executive officer here, the executive secretary is going to be the chief executive officer. Shall be appointed, and listen to the word, it's mandatory, shall be appointed by the president after consultation with the board, or in the rare situation where there is no board, is the other governing body, and the governing body here is the commission. So failing to consult them in appointing the CEO will be unconstitutional. But those of you who also said the president should not be involved in the appointment is the other extreme. That is also wrong. So the way it is absolutely correct.
Yes.
Now, AG, when you look at the same, saying, you know, you look at the board of directors or other governing body of the public enterprise. Here it is not a commission, it's the enterprise. Probably, I don't know, look at it properly. It's not very clear.
Ikungulindi.
Wuli is.
Under the supervision. Yeah, it's under the supervision. Yes, Chair, let's look at it again. You know, if you look at C, if you read C, it's subject to the supervision.
C where?
Is 13.3C. Of the bill. The executive secretary shall be, you know, et cetera, subject to the supervision and control of the members of the commission. So if they are going to supervise him and they are going to control him, then it is fitting that they can recommend to the president.
Yes.
You understand? He's going to work directly under them.
I want to add, honorable member, that I don't know whether it's within my purview to make suggestions here, but instead of subjecting the executive secretary to the supervision and control of the members, it should be to the supervision and control of the commission, not the members. Because otherwise, every single member will have the right to control him. I think the power of the commission lies in the commission. Yes. So the executive secretary should be supervised and controlled by the commission, not the members of the commission. Because he's not answerable to them individually. He is answerable to them as a commission. And I think that is important you clarify that.
Nominated Member Kevalang Pogon.
Honorable Speaker. Yo. Honorable Chair. I was having undivided attention. That's why I paused. Honorable Chair, at some point we need to have closure. I mean, at some point, there should be closure. Members have divergent opinions. We've heard from members. We've heard the advice of the Attorney General. My proposal will be put the question right now. If there is a division, we go for a vote. And we've had the Constitution. Wait. We've had the Constitution. If there is any organ of the state that should respect the Constitution, it should be the National Assembly. This is not about personal opinion. It's about law. So put the question on the wheelchair. We move. This bill has been lingering for a long time. Let's move, huh? Thank you.
Kiyang West.
Honorable Chair, I'm still not with the view that this commission is a public enterprise. And I urge the minister to definitely give us a justification to stand this commission as a public enterprise. Otherwise, we will call every school and every hospital in this country a public enterprise. And to be honest, this commission is not a public enterprise. This commission is not a public enterprise. If they think it's a public enterprise, let them give us justifications for that.
Yes. Chair.
Attorney General,
can I come in?
Well, I can only refer you to Section 175.1. Do you have your constitution with you? So, that's not me, that's the constitution. It says in this constitution, public enterprise means any body corporate. And this is a body corporate because it's been created by law and it can sue and can be sued. Or other body or institution wholly owned or controlled by government. And you people, legislating is a creature and is going to be a body corporate and is owned by government and controlled by government. Because you are going to be approving their budgets and they will be reporting to you and all whatnot. So it has all the features of a body corporate.
There is Honorable Chair. Please, Chair.
As amended,
Chair.
Stands part of the bill. You are saying we progress. You are saying sorry. You're saying sorry. All right, I'll open the floor.
Chair, let me. You give me the floor.
Sabasanjal, go ahead.
Yes, Honorable Chair. I'm still not convinced. Thank you,
Honorable Chair,
for that clarification.
Honorable Chair, please, is it? No, some of these people have talk. Nobody can convince them. Them
you don't have anything to say on this, so you keep quiet.
Why?
If you don't have anything to say, you keep quiet.
We have something to say. If you don't have the brain to...
You don't know anything on this, you keep quiet.
Decorum.
Shut up if you don't have anything to say. People will clarify themselves. We will not be a rubber stamp in this assembly.
Order.
If you want to be, you get out of here.
Order, please.
Honorable Chair, I need clarification here.
Please, members, order. Yeah, I'll come to you.
My doubt has to be clear. I will not just be saying yes here like that.
Keep the fire. Order. Please, honorable members, order. Please, I wanted to put the question, but honorable members, the majority among the leaders requested the floor. So, I'll come to you.
Chair, I had the floor.
Please.
I want to help them here to understand that the
I don't need any help. Order.
Let me be clarified.
Sabasanjal, put off your mic. Put off your mic.
I need clarity.
Yes. Order, please. Honorable members. Honorable members.
Chair, point of order.
There's point of order from the member who is.
Yes. Yes, every time. Order 17. Yes, it's behavior of members. Where is it? It's behavior of members. Yes. He said all members. Yes, members shall not. No, that's not. Wait, members. No, it's not A. It's. while a member is speaking, all other members shall be silent and shall not make unseemly interruption. So no member, no member shall, without the consent of the speaker, etc., etc. But that's the one. So no, we should be serious. Everybody should just raise your tack, and it's left to the speaker to say, member that, and then that person speaks, and we all keep silent. Let's keep decorum. That's what it is saying, including opinion. Please.
Thank you very much, Honourable Member, for Woodley East. Order sustained. And Honourable Members, please, let me repeat. If you want to participate in the debate, raise your constituency tag. And if members are submitting their opinion or proposal or suggestion, please silence and be quiet so that the process will be fast. We will progress in the interest of time and in the interest of our service to the nation. But if you keep interrupting and arguing unnecessarily, we'll spend the night here. We won't do justice to the bill. Please, the member of Sabasanyal is on the floor, and I appeal that members stop arguing and confronting and verbal attack. And if you want us, we don't use the mic, please. Sabasanyal.
Thank you very much, Honorable Chair. I just wanted to refer the Honorable Minister to Section 173 under where you have, under establishment of commission, you have powers of appointment. I think if I get it right, it's under Section 173, subsection 5. Let's look at that together. I think that is what will help us here. Section 5 and 6. If I may read, the power to appoint person to hold or act in any office in an institution of higher education, research or professional training established within the public service shall vest in the governing body of that institution. Subsection 6, the commission shall in any case in which this constitution requires an appointment to be made after or in consultation with or on the recommendation of the commission, exercise its powers in that regard and may, at the request of the president or the competent authority concerned, render advice or appointment with their respective powers. Will that give us good? I'm just asking, Honorable Minister, if you can help me. Yeah.
Section 173(5) that you cited deals with specific institutions, higher education, research, and professional training institutions. So it's not applicable to this commission.
Member for Birkama North and Minority Leader.
Thank you very much. Honorable Chair, I was only saying before you put to vote, we take note of the proposed amendments. One is 13(2) by removing the last words and the commission. And then the second one that was proposed by the minister at 3(c) by removing of the members and limiting to only of the commission. So that's why I was saying before you put to vote, let's take note of the two proposed amendments.
In fact, we've noted it since the minister, yeah. It was going to form part of the amendment. Kantora and Majority Leader.
Just saying, if you go by the provision in 75(3), as he cited, for us to please make headway, I'm appealing to all members to vote on that line.
Yes, Chair, I raised my tag, but you never called me. So I just want members to go back to clause 3 to know who the commissioners are and through which process they go for their selections, including the majority and minority leader and members of the public as well. So then there is no doubt about the integrity of these commissioners. So I think this thing, we should just move on.
Please,
and you took the floor without permission. It is proposed that clause 13, as amended, stands part of the bill. Those in favor, please say aye. Those not in favor, please say no. The ayes have it.
Sorry, I just want to appeal to members.
Clause 14.
I'm on floor, unless if you ask me to.
Honorable member, please go ahead.
Thank you very much. I just want to appeal to members that this one was committed to a committee, and they did a good job, and they made some recommendations. Before we just go there and there, we should look at the comments that they made, and we debate on those merits. And we've been guided by the Constitution. If we are having any doubt, the minister come on board and give us clarification. Thank you.
Clerk.
Clause 14, appointment of the officers and staff of the commission.
Clause 14, appointment of the officers and staff of the commission. Committee? Members, please.
Yes, the committee didn't have any recommendation. However, based on the previous clause, if you look at 2, an officer appointed under subsection 1 shall be subject to the direct control and supervision of the members of the commission. So we made, just to be consistent, we remove of the members and wherever it applies in the bill. Yeah.
Their proposal is the of the members. And wherever it appears in the bill.
Article D.
Yes, there is this also submission that the removal of the executive secretary is missing.
Boy, please relax and behave. If the majority caucus can behave like this, no matter what they can do. Jimmy is smiling. Jimmy don't fight. Go and fight. We are here.
The other one is in your caucus. The other one is an independent candidate.
No. Don't mix stones and eggs. We know what.
No.
A peacemaker, you are back. Very good. The bottom should happen in the chamber.
Thank you.
Yes, Member for Pasalum.
Thank you very much, Honorable Chair. I want to move a motion for the removal of the executive secretary. And that should be inserted immediately after this clause. And it will read, the executive secretary may only be removed from office for A, inability to perform the functions of his or her office arising out of physical or mental incapacity, or B, for gross misconduct or incompetence. And then another subclause says, before the executive secretary is removed from the office, he or she shall be informed of the case against him or her and be given adequate opportunity to defend himself or herself against any allegations made against him or her. And three, the commission shall appoint a deputy executive secretary on such terms and conditions as shall be determined by the commission. And the last one is the deputy executive secretary shall assist the executive secretary in the performance of the executive secretary's functions. So at least we have a clause that would show the removal.
It's extracted from the
Any second?
Observation on that motion.
Any second?
Just a little observation
no,
on that.
No, please. You will observe after, please. Please. That will be an amendment. Member for Brikama North and Minority Leader.
I second the motion.
Obasalu.
Any observation? Yes, Member for Wooly East.
Yes, thank you. I did not, from what the Honorable Member proposed, I think you should start with saying that the member should be removed, can be removed, or shall be removed by the president. Then you continue. But the person responsible for removing has not been mentioned.
Yes.
Honourable Chair.
Please, Member for Olindo.
We did not hear the exact insertion that the Honourable Member wanted to put in the clause. I don't know. You read it, but we did not hear you clearly.
You are not listening.
Okay. What we are trying to do is the removal procedure of the executive secretary is not captured in the bill. So we are introducing a new clause immediately after 13 to make a new 14. And that's going to give the procedure how to remove the executive secretary. That's what I was reading. And we picked this up from the National Human Rights Commission Act of 2017.
Yeah. Okay, member for Kiang West.
Yes. I want to suggest that the appointing authority should be the removing authority. Because you cannot give him the powers to appoint and you give somebody the powers to remove. So I suggest that the appointing authority still has the powers, you know, to remove with the right procedures.
Yes, that's what Uli is was suggesting, but also that's the grounds. The grounds also should be highlighted. The process and procedures of removing.
Yeah. Can he reread his submission? Did you give me the floor?
Go ahead, sir.
Yes. Can you reread your submission so that we can affirm?
Please go ahead.
Obasalu, page, please.
Please, members, avoid using the mic if you are not giving the floor.
Okay.
Obasalu,
I'm reading from the National Human Rights Commission Act 2017. It will say the president may remove the executive secretary from office for A, inability to perform the functions of his or her office arising out of physical or mental incapacity, or B, gross misconduct or incompetence. Then subclause 2 says, before the executive secretary is removed from office, he or she shall be informed of the case against him or her and be given adequate opportunity to defend himself or herself against any allegations made against him or her. And then you add the commission shall appoint a deputy executive secretary on such terms and conditions, and then the deputy executive secretary shall assist the executive secretary in the performance of his functions. That's all.
That's in order. Let's move.
No, I'm reading from the National Human Rights Commission. We insert immediately after 13 to make it 14. Immediately after 13 to make it 14, yeah.
It is proposed that the new clause as...
No.
Yeah. King West?
I didn't get it well. So I was saying, is it upon recommendation of the commission?
Yeah, thank you.
How is it put to the notice of the president that so commissioner is not performing to the expectation and that he removes? That's what I'm asking. Is it upon recommendation of the commission? Then the president removes. Don't just say yes. This has to be clear.
That is for vision and control of the commission.
Yes, you know the executive secretary actually is under the supervision of the commission itself, and you would expect that an appraisal would be done to show his incompetence. So essentially, there is no need to add that; it would be redundant. So
The proposal is that please order. The proposal is that a new clause be inserted as read by the member for Upper Salo.
Enough.
Those in favor, please say aye.
No, Chair, where is it
those
going to be inserted?
Those in favor, please say no. Please don't use your mic if you're going to give it the floor.
After 13, it will be new 14.
It is proposed that clause 14, the new 14, stands part of the bill. Those in favor, please say aye. Those not in favor, please say no. The ayes have it. Now, it is 21, 22 to 3. Now the House will resume, and then we will suspend the committee stage, and then House will resume. The House resumes. The time is 21:03, and we shall go for break for an hour and resume 15:21. The House is suspended.
Sea alleviation, especially for developing countries around the world. This microfinance service adheres to the principles of Islam as a form of social responsibility. Yona Islamic Microfinance is the Islamic microfinance of choice in the Gambia, trustworthy and reliable. At Yona Islamic Microfinance, we provide savings products, current accounts, financing products in conformity with Islam. In addition, Yona Islamic Microfinance also offers local and international remittances, takaful fund, management of zakat, management of awqaf, trading and investment, and building of strategic partnerships to bring financial services to the doorstep of the poor with donor projects, madrasas, youth organizations, women groups, and farmer organizations. Make a choice with Yona Islamic Microfinance today. For more information on Yona Islamic Microfinance, call 377-2151 or 9832-151 or visit Yona Head Office at Tipa Garage, Bakote, or visit any Yona branch located countrywide near you.
Yo, I'm not transfer. You're
transfer.
Ha, code you.
Okay. What's that? ID sort of.
Sorry. I got it.
Bidan bro.
Alba.
Mbaka.
But Allah sabi so tariya.
Janum yona forest de bureau. Gambia tonkon na lumbaria bere. Ha. Birim koina fo kato.
Bari sikodo kino kato ni fo bolong blabe.
56 branches mola soto Gambia ja.
Ha?
Ka. Gambia kono alin Gambia bantala bankol. Nko kono kia bele. Kodo sifa fo falindiro fo nyaadi nafta memmen na kodi to poto ni ko di maraw. Jannam nomba wati nyonta. Andum fana nata anoda enterprise sotale.
Wolam
nyindi ko domorol fana kol fana be firale da dadi mane domorol ni fana be teat.
Ha.
Gambia dawda yalo Kendall Sotaleji.
I fell in that.
I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I fell in that. I f